You ever hear that? Yeah. Have you ever used that? Yeah. The good old days. What were they? Now, most of what I'm going to say for a little bit is going to be from my perspective on those good old days. It was a time when we had clean water and clean air, clean rivers. There was no energy crisis. There's a lot of good to be said about the good old days. What is your perspective on the good old days? Do you have one?
Simplicity.
I'm sorry?
Simplicity.
Yeah. The good old days.
Probably when I could leg out an in the park home run. Now they're just double.
Yeah. You know, today we pick up the newspaper or we watch the news, and on page one of the newspaper or the first item on the news is, there has been another murder in our community. And if you go to page two and the second item in the news, it's, we now have another energy crisis. You don't even want to go any further, right? Yeah, I would like to read one of these newspaper articles. The world is too big for us. Too much is going on. Too many crimes, too much violence, too much excitement. Try as you will, you still seem to get behind in this race. Science empties its discoveries on us so fast that you stagger in hopeless bewilderment. The political world is running so fast one cannot keep up. How much more can human nature endure? Anybody remember reading that article? I would assume not. It was printed in the Atlantic Journal, June 16th, 1833. Yeah, back in the good old days. So what about those good old days? Again, from my perspective, children were dying from a disease called polio. One had to take a bath in a number two tub, as they called it. I remember, I'm sure they had other vehicles, but I remember the first car I remember my parents owning is, you had to start it with something called a crank. Yeah, if you didn't get it the first time, but you better get your arm out of the way, because when that thing catches, right? Whoever started anything with a crank, huh? Oh my. Yeah. You know, everything depends on one's perspective. Charles Dickens' famous line still applies today. It was the best of times, it was the worst of times. Now, what does God's word say about times, the good old days? In the book of Daniel, chapter 2, verses 20 and 21, it says, praise be to the name of God forever and ever. Wisdom and power are His. He changes times and seasons. He disposes of kings and raises up others. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to the discerning. What assurance we have from God's word. No matter what, God is still in control. Right? God is still in control. The psalmist David says in Psalms 31:15, "My times are in your hands." Do we truly believe that? My times are in his hands. Do we truly believe that? If we do, then change would not be so difficult, would it? Change would not cause such anxiety in us that it does. You see, there is nothing in this, I'm amazed every day. There's always something new in technology. There's always something new, you know. You need to buy this little thing because it does so much more than this little thing you bought yesterday does. But there's nothing in technology, there's nothing in science that catches God off guard. He is right on time, every time. If we believe that God is sovereign, then you cannot believe that God is ever out of date. He's never behind. Quite frankly, I find that rather exciting. God has got it under control. We look at our world today, God has got it under control. There's so many areas we can look at when we talk about change, but I'm going to talk about one that is very difficult. Why does the church find it so difficult to change? Why? If God is in control, why does the church find it so difficult to change? If we come before God and ask him for his wisdom, his direction, his input into what he would have us to do, change ought to be exciting. Not, Many years ago, a Sunday school teacher was relieved of her class because she introduced a new method of teaching, something that was called flannel graph. Anybody remember flannel graph? Yeah. That came straight from the pit of hell, is what the church said. Out the door she goes. While we were in Macon, Georgia, we had a missionary couple come to our church. They had spent 25 years in the land of Indonesia. And I remember them talking about their task there, their job, especially for the lady. For 25 years, they were translating the Bible into the Indonesian language. And she was able to say that we finished it in 2 years. Thanks to a thing called a computer. Now, what did the church say when the computer first came out? That is straight from the pit of Satan. Don't touch it. Stay away from it. Now, suppose they had felt that way. As she said, we would have never finished what we started. after 25 years. Change. Now, grab this. Unless a particular method is set forth in Scripture as an unchanging method God says we are to use, it is temporary at best. Suppose the church still lived the way, or functioned the way it used to. When I grew up in the church, you sang three hymns. On the chorus of the third hymn, the ushers would come forward. You would have a word of prayer. You would take the offering. The preacher would stand up, give his message. You would sing another hymn, and then you would say amen and go home. You could count on it every Sunday. I mean, clockwork. Boom. You know, three hymns. Well, this hymn's got five verses. We can only sing three, or we're going to be behind. Suppose the church never changed. Would we be reaching the culture of society today? No. That's why I like what we do. Change. It's good. Because God is in it. David asked an important question in chapter 11 of Psalms, verse 3. When the foundations are being destroyed, what can the righteous do? And what David is asking is this: Lord, what can the righteous do if everything is up for grabs? What can we do if everything changes so fast, so much, that even you begin to change? And I believe we have the answer to that question in 2 Timothy 2:19, where Paul writes to Timothy and says, God's foundation stands firm. God's not going to change. So that means one thing. Who's got to change? Can we expect the church to change if we're not willing to change? How can we expect the church to change unless we are willing to change? What about that one thing? Maybe it's more. I'm going to stick with one. That one thing in our lives that we say, God, hands off. God says, I want to change you. And we say, hands off. And that is the one thing that is keeping us from becoming all that God has for us. One thing. When I felt the call into the ministry, I had a wife that was praying for years. I had a dear friend. She was praying longer than that. She told me years and years ago that one day I would be doing what I'm doing, and I, you gotta be kidding. Whoa. But I come to the point where I say, okay, God, I'll do it, but don't do this. And it was rather simple thing, I thought. God, I don't want to be a missionary. I don't want to go to some country and live out in the bush and do all of that stuff. And then I realized that God knows me. And therefore, He is not going to send me someplace where I don't want to go. I remember I candidated in Casa Grande, Arizona. And I thought, when I got word that this is where this superintendent wanted to send me, I got a call one afternoon, and Gene was at work, and I was still in college. She come home. I said, honey, the handwriting's on the wall. Big, bold letters. I know where we're going. Because you see, several years before that, when I was in first semester English, one of our projects we had to do was write a resume. And our denomination that was in then had a directory that covered the whole country. And in fact, it covered the world. You could find a missionary wherever, about yay thick. And I took that book, laid it on my desk, just flipped some pages, pointed at a church. That's it. Guess where I wrote a resume for about 5 years before? Casa Grande, Arizona. I know where we're going. I picked it out 5 years ago. The problem was I picked it. God didn't. Because I was there 5 minutes and I said, I want to go home. That door was closed tighter than one of the things that they offered me was a trailer that sat about 12 miles out of town, out in the middle of the desert. There it is, good luck. Okay, I don't mind trailer life, but We had to come to the point, you know, God, wherever you want me, it don't matter. Can we expect the church to change and for us to stay the same? Are you where God wants you to be in your commitment to Him, first of all, and then in your commitment to the church? And I believe that this change begins like any other change that happens in our lives. It begins with one step. You know, when you accepted Christ as your Savior, if you were in a church setting, you probably stood up and took one step toward the altar where you then prayed for forgiveness, you know, or wherever you were at. You took one step, whether it was mentally or physically, you took one step. You had a change of mind. One step is all it takes. And that is all that is needed for us to see a change in us as individuals, and then to see the change in the church that we are longing for, that we are expecting to happen here. That begins with one step. And it's only by God's grace and mercy, as we open ourselves to what God has for us, that we can survive. Let me change that. It's only by God's grace and mercy for us that we will thrive, that we will triumph in what God has for us. Right? Yeah. One step. I've heard a song, I've heard it a lot lately. And I asked Joanna, Pastor Brendan called me Wednesday and said, do you think you can take over Sunday? Absolutely, no problem. And when I knew the direction I was heading, I asked Joanna Thursday, I want you all to learn a new song by Sunday, and she said, I don't think so. and I understand that that's all right. But we have it on, going to come up on the screen in a minute. If you know the words, stand up, clap your hands, do whatever you want to do. But you know, if God has really spoken to your heart this morning, will you take that one step? Take that one step and say, God, I want to change. I want you to change me. That's all it takes. We're one step away. Jim?
You could go back and relive one day of your life all over again, and unmake the mistake that left you a million miles away from the you once knew. Now yesterday's shame keeps saying that you'll never get back on track. But what if I told you you're one step away from surrender?
One step away, that's all it is. That's all it is. For the biggest change in your life to take place. Let's pray. Father, dismiss us this morning. We thank you for this time together, worship and praise. We thank you that you're never more than one step away. When we make that decision, you're there. To lay down the old chains, that which has bound us for so long, and to pick up that new name. What a change. Dismiss us with your blessing now in your name. Amen.